I'm an assistant professor in Wrocław at Wrocław University of Science and Technology. Lately, we gained this science part in the name of the university. And as you can see, this is a very nice university, very nice campus with historical buildings, with some new infrastructure. The campus is on the two banks of the river, Odra River, and probably we are the only one campus in the world that has a cable car that can take you from the one side of the river to the other one. Okay, so this is the place where I also started my higher education, up to the bachelor degree, but then I was enrolled in an Erasmus Mundus Master of Excellence program called MonaBiFOT, Molecular Nano and Biophotonics. And in fact, that was the first time that I saw how the international community and how the multidisciplinary studies can be beneficial, can be very exciting. And there I decided that this is something that I want to do in my future. So the program is in three different countries, in France, Poland, and Spain. And it teaches you how to work on the border between physics, chemistry, and biology. So with my master thesis, I investigated DNA liquid crystal phases. And as you may heard, DNA is a lyotropic liquid crystal. And in my studies, I treated DNA not as a functional biological molecule, but as a biopolymer. And I investigated how the increasing concentration of DNA induces the self-organization of strands from the isotropic phase to precholesteric phase, cholesteric one, columnar hexagonal, and up to the crystal phase. And after that studies, or during that studies, I looked for some methods that can investigate very precisely what is the ordering of molecules in three dimensions, preferably with some optical methods and non-destructive, and methods that can help you observe dynamic events. And for us, the method of choice at that time was two-photon-excited fluorescence. And for those of you who are not familiar with the technique, in a conventional fluorescence microscope, you have one photon excitation. So in order to see the fluorescence, you shine the visible light or UV light, and you excite the photon from the ground state to the excited state, and then you observe the fluorescence. In two-photon microscope, you do the same, but with the simultaneous absorption of two photons. And then you observe also the resulting fluorescence. Why is it interesting, and what are the benefits? So, first of all, in order to see this kind of the event, you need a simultaneous absorption of two photons, so you need a very high photon density, very high intensity of the light. And you can obtain that just with the pulsed laser beams, for example, femtosecond laser beams. And as you can see in this photograph, if you have like a one-photon microscope, you eliminate the sample with fluorophores, you see the emission from the whole light path from the two cones of light, whereas when you eliminate with femtosecond laser beam, you have the excitation just in the focal point of the microscope. Maybe it's not very well visible, but you can trust me that there is like a very precisely localized spot. And you can imagine that with this technique, you can move the sample around and do the 3D imaging without much of the phototoxicity which you introduce here. So that is the first advantage. And the second one is that with two-photon microscopy, as you can see from this image, you introduce the photons with the half of the energy of the photons that you use in one-photon excitation. That means that you work in the different range of wavelengths, and in fact, near infrared range of wavelengths, so they fall in the so-called optical biological window. And in this window, you can see that the absorption of the intrinsic components of tissues and cells is the lowest. So you can penetrate with your light deeper into the biological samples. Okay, so I started my PhD studies in between Poland and France. And in fact, I took the expertise in preparation of DNA liquid crystal phases to France, to ENS de Cachan, where they developed a two-photon microscope with polarization analysis. So in this technique, we have this two-photon excitation, but we control the polarization of the incident light. And then we collect this fluorescent signal and split it into X and Y component. And we do that in order to see how the fluorophores are organized in the sample. So if we have like the isotropic sample, then our X and Y component are perpendicular to each other. But if we have organized fluorophores, X and Y component tend to align in the direction that corresponds to the direction of emitting dipoles. And in my studies, I used fluorophores with a well-known DNA binding modes. For example, propionic iodide, which is an intercalator. And so each time it binds with DNA strands in the same way, it's like perpendicular to the long axis of DNA. That's why when we image what is the orientation of propionic iodide, we can tell what is the orientation of DNA. And indeed, we perform such as studies with DNA liquid crystal phases. We scan the chosen area of the sample. Here is like a two-photon fluorescence intensity map. And with this microscope, we can do this polarization analysis in well-defined points of the sample. And you can see that you truly see what is the orientation of DNA in all of that spot and that it changes when you cross the border between two liquid crystal domains. We did that also in 3D. As I mentioned, with this technique, you can easily prepare like a three-dimensional maps of organization of molecules. That was the part of my PhD studies, and in fact, at that level also, for the first time, met with the Foundation for Polish Science, because I was accepted to the welcome program of Professor Marek Samoć, who started a group at our university in 2009, the group doing nonlinear optics in nanophotonics and biophotonics. So if you're not familiar with this kind of program, Foundation for Polish Science used to have a program for renowned professors from abroad to attract them to come to Poland and set a group. And in a group of Professor Samoć, I learned more about nonlinear optics and how to use it to study materials. And just to briefly introduce you to the idea of nonlinear optics, our everyday observation of light-matter interaction usually is linear. Because sun, because lamps, because low power, low intensity lasers introduce in a material just a change of the polarization that corresponds to the first element of this equation. But if you use a high power laser, if you use a pulsed laser light, you start to observe phenomena that are connected with the higher order components of this equation. So your material tries to produce new events. For example, you can observe this two-photon absorption that I described a few slides before. And in fact, in the frame of Welcome Program, it was possible to build several setups at our university to investigate this two-photon absorption quantitatively, for example, with a Z-scan technique. So in this case, we can tell not only that we see this nonlinear phenomena, but also how efficient they are, what are the two-photon absorption cross-sections, what are the changes of nonlinear refractive indices, and all of that information we could collect for chemical and biological samples. And with the Z-scan technique, I investigated two-photon properties of DNA-binding fluorophores, such as ethidium bromide or hex dyes. And as you can see, we did experiments in the broad range of wavelengths. So we collected like that whole two-photon absorption spectra of these molecules. And this is not very common because it's quite a time-consuming and tedious work to do. We also investigated, and I also investigated in my PhD studies, more sophisticated molecules that were designed to be very good photon absorbers. For example, we proved that if you introduce iridium ions into this kind of quadrupolar molecules, you gain like a one order of the increase of two photon absorption cross section. So from this values like 200 Geppert-Meyers, you reach something like thousands of Geppert-Meyers, and also you can observe three photon absorption in such complexes. Okay, so work in the group of Professor Samoj was very nice, as he was not like a regular Polish professor, but he spent like 20 years in Australia and in States, and after that came back to Poland. So you may imagine that his approach to doing science was a bit different. However, the group was still developing. So to learn different techniques that I applied in my PhD studies, I needed to spend some time abroad. In fact, at ANU, in the laser physics lab, and as I mentioned, also in Ernest de Cachon. So in fact, like the substantial part of my experience came from this abroad studies. And at that point, in these both institutions, I learned different techniques connected with nonlinear optics. But here I also want to mention my undergraduate summer research fellowship that I did in ICFO already as a student, because at that time I learned, and in fact I very enjoyed working on plasmonic gold particles and biosensors. I thought during my PhD studies that that knowledge will be like something useless. However, it turned out that there appeared a possibility to apply the gold particles in my studies, and this is what I will explain in further slides. So a brief introduction to plasmonic nanoparticles. If you have a small metal crystals, you obtain a new properties that are not present in the bulk gold. So for example, for small gold spheres, you excite surface plasmon resonance when you place them in the electromagnetic field. So in fact, if you illuminate them with light, and you have one resonant wavelength that is appearing in this extinction spectrum as a one band. If you play with the shape, for example, you produce a nanorod, you have the two surface plasma resonant wavelengths, a transverse one and longitudinal one. And as you can see, by playing with the shape of these structures, you can tune the optical properties in a wide range of wavelengths. And in fact, by wet chemistry methods, you can produce well-controlled shapes and sizes of gold nanoparticles. And the important part of these plasmonic excitations is that with the plasmons, you obtain very high local field enhancement around the nanoparticle surface. And where you can use this kind of events. So plasmons can produce a luminescence of nanoparticles. They can produce photoacoustic effects, and they can heat the surrounding of the nanoparticles. And all of that phenomena I will try to use in imaging of biological samples. So here just some pretty pictures of nanoparticles that were produced in our laboratory, and some of the results of investigation of nonlinear optical properties of gold nanoparticles. So in fact, I performed this kind of studies on various gold nanoparticles, but here I will show just the gold nanorods, who turned out to be the best two-photon absorbers and very efficient markers for two-photon microscopy. We investigated the full two-photon absorption cross-section, and we also compared the values that we obtained with the values of various nanoparticles and the best two-photon absorbing organic molecules. As you can see, gold nanoparticles seem to be far best two-photon absorbers. However, if you compare like a if you introduce a merit factor, so to photon absorption cross section divided by the molecular weight of the dye or of the nanocrystal, you can see that the most efficient species are gold nanorods. And with my studies during PhD, I try to explain why it is the case and what is responsible for this very high, very efficient photon absorption. But apart from the like the quantitative characterization, I also introduced gold nanorods into DNA liquid crystal phases. And here you can see the DNA liquid crystal and the two-photon fluorescence intensity scan with a single gold nanorods inside. So you can very efficiently image these nanorods, and when you use the different polarization of the incident light, you can also tell what is the orientation of a nanorod in these samples. But what we observe with the studies, if you focus on a single nanorod, you observe the dramatic decrease of two-photon excited luminescence, and the scan in the same place reveals that the nanorod is missing. The same for the other particle. So what is happening here is that with a higher dose of light, you introduce local heating. And what is very interesting in that case, it is that you use femtosecond laser illumination, and you have very localized heating, restricted just to the near surrounding of a nanoparticle. You can see here that we have two nanorods that are like half a micron apart, and we remove one of them, but the second one stays in the same place. And you must have in mind that here you have this DNA in the form of a liquid crystal. So if you increase the temperature, we believe you introduce a phase transition. You have like a liquid matrix, and in such a way, the nanorod can be pulled out of the focus of the laser beam. With such a studies, we can claim that potentially gold nanorods can be very nice theranostic probes. And this term means that you have an object that can do the therapy and the diagnostics. In case of nanorods, diagnostics will be the imaging of the ordering of the system that the nanorod is introduced in. And therapy will be photothermal therapy, because with a higher dose of light, you can locally heat the environment. Okay, so that was studies that I did during my PhD. And in fact, thanks to the Wellcome program, and then thanks to other grants, I was able to build multiphoton microscopy at the Wrocław University of Science and Technology. And I set my laboratory. At that time, I also received two supports from Foundation for Polish Science, two scholarships, START scholarship and START scholarship with distinctions. And all of that convinced me that maybe I can do a good science staying in Poland, and maybe I can be supported there. And in fact, the very important event was also the participation in the Lindau Nobel Laureate meeting. I don't know if you heard about this kind of meetings, but every year in Lindau, Lindau Foundation invites a Nobel Laureates from one discipline or from all life science disciplines, as it was in 2015 when I was there. And you have something like 65 Nobel laureates, plenty of young researchers from all around the world, and you have a very good place to interact with the professors. You have lectures, you have panel discussions, you have lunches and dinners together. You spend time all the time with all of that group of people. So at that point, it was, as I said, very inspirational. Because you probably already feel that science is not only about money and financial support, but also about the interaction with people and the inspiration from the drive that other scientists have. And also participation in this Lindau laureate meeting, by the way, in Poland, like in different countries, there are institutions who are responsible for pre-selection of candidates for this kind of meeting, and in Poland it is Foundation for Polish Science. And I don't know how it works if you are abroad, but you can just check on their webpage. And then the Lindau Foundation chooses the candidates and covers all the expenses of this kind of meeting. Okay, so at that point, I decided that I want to learn from the best, and I spent some time in UC Berkeley and then at the University of Cambridge. It wasn't like a full postdoc, but rather it was like some visits and internships. And what was important there, that I saw two nice labs, two great labs, that combine scientists with different backgrounds, that they can work side by side, especially in Cambridge. This is like a model lab and model group for me, because in this laser analytics group, you have people from biology, growing neurons, doing biochemistry, side by side, physicists who develop microscopes, who are doing optics and photonics. And in fact, on that basis, I shaped like the idea of the group that I want to lead, and I shaped the idea of the NONA project. And last year, I applied for first team program of the Foundation for Public Science, and my project was accepted. So this year, I started NONA, so nonlinear optics, nanoparticles, and amyloids project. So the main objective of this project is to study amyloid formation. So basically, amyloids are aggregates of misfolded proteins, and from polypeptides, spontaneously, some unstable aggregates are developed, for example, native-like aggregates or disordered aggregates. And under some circumstances, which are not well understood yet, some of these aggregates transform into thermodynamically stable species that then grow into fibers. And these kind of aggregates are called amyloids, and they are very important. They are formed from something like 40 peptides and proteins in our body. They are important because they are found in many serious human pathologies. It is not still arguable if they are a cause or a result of these pathologies, but for sure they are worth studying. And with my project, even with the initial studies did in our group several years ago, we claim that nonlinear optical techniques and multiphoton excitation in such structures can help to distinguish between different levels of the amyloid formation and in fact detect amyloid formation in samples. And in my studies, I also want to apply gold nanoparticles to boost the auto fluorescence and to boost the intrinsic properties of amyloids in this nonlinear optical regime. And in fact, I already formed a group of one postdoc to PhD students and two master's students. And my collaborators in the project are Professor Kaminski from University of Cambridge and Professor Krenzel from EGPMC in France. And in fact, in this group is like the Institute of Genetics and Biological and Molecular Biology. They grow neurons. They have mice. So they will help me to introduce my findings in like biologically relevant systems. Okay, so with that, I want to finish, and I want to invite you for the lecture of Maria Pawłowska after the coffee break. She will tell you more about Foundation for Public Science and projects that are available there right now. Thank you.